My name is Paul Bevan, and I'm a Senior Technical Product Manager at Siemens Digital Industry Software. And today, I'd like to discuss with you how you can design efficiently and effectively in NX with imported data. So let's start by looking at imported 3D data. Now this can come from any CAD system, and in a variety of formats. It could be a STEP file. It could be a JT file with embedded BREP. It could even be the result of a topology optimization, which would be a facet body. It doesn't really make any difference to NX. It can work with all these data types effectively. And the tools to allow us to do this reside within Synchronous Modeling. Synchronous Modeling has 35 powerful commands for simple direct manipulation of both native and non-native solid, sheet, and facet models, whether these have features or not. It has intelligence-driven selection of topology, which enables rapid design modifications. It's also important to understand that Synchronous Modeling features are fully parametric, and they reside in the part history alongside all of the other modeling features, and are fully editable, just like any other NX feature. So let's take a look at Synchronous Modeling in action. So let's take a look at how you can use Synchronous Modeling with inside of NX to make modifications to imported 3D data. In the graphics window, you can see a machine casting comprising of one single body. So there aren't any features that we can use to make the modifications. We're going to have to use Synchronous Modeling in NX to change the topology. The first synchronous command I'm going to use is move face, and I'm going to use it to reposition the wall that separates two pockets. Now that I've selected the first face, the intelligent face finder inside of NX has found an offset, which in this case will be the other side of the wall. So I choose it together with a corner blend and drag the wall to the new position. You'll also notice all of the other blends adapt to this change. The next task is to offset a couple of the radial faces within the casting. And to do this, I simply select both the faces and using offset region, just drag the faces again to a new position. The final modification in this area is to move this radial face. And to do this, I first need to modify the position of the dynamic drag handles to this arc center so that I can then rotate the face around to its new position. So let's take a look at the other side of the component and see what needs to be done there. The first task I want to perform is to modify some of the fixing holes. So I'm going to use resize hole. Select one of the holes that I want to change, and you'll notice that the face finder has found a number of similar sized holes on the same face. So I'm going to select all of these holes, and rather than changing the size of the hole, I'm going to change its type from simple to countersunk. It adds in a countersunk diameter, and I can modify the size of that diameter, and then complete the command. And it's applied that to every hole that was found on that same face. My next task is to modify the position of a couple of those holes and the corresponding boss around it. I simply use Window Select to pick up the faces. I change the direction vector by selecting one of the existing edges and then dynamically reposition the hole and the bosses, and again you see all of the blends adapting to the new position. Now let's take a look at something a little bit more complex. I want to change the size of this pocket. So I'm going to select one of the walls of the pocket. Again, I get the option to select the offset. And then we can continue to pick some of the geometry that I want to move. Again, using some of the intelligent selection types, such as coaxial and offset, I can get the geometry that I need to move. And again, I can dynamically drag the pocket to change its position. I may want to make sure that the wall thickness on this area of the pocket remains constant. So again, I select those, and as I drag the pocket, notice that all of the topology adapts to the new size. So I've modified one area of the pocket. Let's take a look at modifying another area. I'm just going to select some faces that I want to move. Again, I could use Intelligent Face Finder if it was going to give me what I needed. But here I'm just selecting individual faces. And then dynamically drag the pocket back out in this direction. Again, notice all of the blends adapting to the new size. If I forget any geometry, it doesn't make any difference. I can just go back in and select it and include it in what I want to reposition. Again, drag it back and forth. You can see everything updating. And you notice one of the walls has got a little bit thinner on the edge just because I've forgotten one of the faces. Not a problem. I just select it and continue to make the adjustment. So I think you saw in that example the power of synchronous modeling together with intelligent face selection to make a significant change to that pocket. So what other type of synchronous modeling changes can I make? Well, let's take a look at this set of holes in this one face. In the original authoring tool, this set of holes might well have been created by using a pattern feature. But we don't have any pattern features in our model. The only features we have are the synchronous ones that I've created. But let's take a look and see if there's something we can use. One of the powerful commands within synchronous modeling is the ability to recognize and resize a pattern. Notice that when I select whole faces, it finds the counterboard geometry, but not only that, it recognizes it as a pattern. Now I can either modify the count of the holes in the pattern, or in this case, dynamically drag the position or the pitch of the hole spacing to suit my modification. Finally, I want to create another set of these holes. Now I could use pattern face, but I'm just going to use another command that I have available, which is copy face. I pick up the hole faces, I set my direction vector, and then copy the hole faces to the area I want them to be positioned, and then paste them into my model. And there we have it, another set of holes created. I have one final modification to make, and that's to the base of the component. I'm going to use move face to reposition this hole and boss. I select the geometry, I specify my direction vector, and drag it to the new position. Again, noticing all of the blends adapting to the new shape. So I've completed all my changes. I'm sure you'll agree that synchronous modeling inside of NX is a powerful tool for working with imported geometry. Together with intelligent selection, we made some quite complex changes to this model extremely easily. Now you've seen how NX works effectively with imported 3D data. Let's take a look at how it works with imported 2D data. Now 2D data itself can come in a number of different neutral file formats, DXF file, DWG file, and the tool that we use inside of NX to manage working with this data is the NX Sketch tool. Now the NX Sketch tool uses a very different sketching paradigm compared to other sketching tools in the market, but we'll discuss that in detail in a second. Typically, when you import 2D geometry, you want to make sure that the geometry is valid. So we have a tool inside of NX called Optimize 2D Curve that fixes any potential geometry problems, such as duplicate curves, overlapping curves, small gaps in curves. It really is a powerful tool to ensure geometry quality. And not only that, as part of the optimized process, it automatically can generate an NX sketch. Now, this imported 2D geometry inside of the sketch utilizes the same powerful capabilities as if the sketch itself was native. And the key to the NX sketch tool is that you don't have to manually add any geometric constraints. All the 2D geometric relations are found automatically by the brand new solver. But these geometric relations only appear when they are required, as, for example, when you're editing the curve. And that will become apparent during the demonstration. So let's take a look at an example of bringing 2D data into NX and how we can work with it effectively within the NX sketch tool. In this demonstration, we're going to take a look at how NX effectively works with imported 2D data. Here we'll import a DXF file and then use the powerful tools in NX to make some modifications to it. It's good practice to clean up the migrated 2D data to remove any anomalies. And to do this, we'll use the Optimize 2D Curve command inside of NX. This command removes duplicate entities, removes tiny lines or arcs. It'll clean up any gaps or overlaps, and also create a sketch of the optimized curves. Once completed, we can activate the sketch, which takes us into the sketch task environment. Now that the 2D migrated data is an NX sketch, the powerful solver has made intelligent assumptions about the 2D profile, which becomes apparent when we start to modify it. Here you can see as I dynamically drag this arc around, it's automatically inferred concentricity and tangency. It also dynamically updated the connectivity between the angle lines and the rest of the profile. And this has all been done automatically by the new solver. I can also start to add dimensions to the profile. I select the arc, the radial dimension automatically appears, and I can dynamically drag it to size. You'll also notice that when I activate the dimension, that one of the found relations appears. In this case, it's a concentric relation between the outer arc and the circle. This was maintained whilst I was dragging the dimension to size. But what happens if I don't want that? Well, if I select the relation, it becomes relaxed and is now not being considered. However, if I want to unrelax it, again I select it and it's now being considered again. I'm going to add one more dimension to the sketch, this time between the y-axis and the arc center. Notice the solver has found other relations, such as equal radius, point on curve, and tangency conditions. The fact that these relations are found automatically by the solver means that you don't have to add them manually, as you would do in other sketch tools. This saves a lot of time and effort. And when I drag the dimension to new size, you can see that the relations are maintained. So I'm going to continue to make some modifications. Here, I'm just going to reposition this arc. In fact, what I really want to do is to position the center of it. Now, I could create dimensions between the arc center and the X and Y axis to position it. Or I could select some other geometry within the sketch to position it too. Notice that when I select the small circle, three dimensions appear that I could use to position the arc center. But I simply want the arc and the circle to be concentric. And to do this, I'm going to make a coincident relation. Notice now that when I drag the arc, the circle moves with it. Let's take a look at another area of the sketch. I'm going to create a dimension between the x-axis and this arc center here. Notice again all of the found relations appear. And when I activate the dimension and start to drag it to a new size, all of these relations are automatically honored and maintained. It's important to remember that just a few minutes ago, this was an imported DXF profile with no intelligence. However, bringing it into NX and then into a sketch has enabled the solver to automatically add intelligence to the profile. Just think of the amount of effort and time it would have taken to have done this manually. The solver's ability to automatically recognize these geometric relations and effectively maintain these relations when making modifications makes NX an extremely productive tool when working with imported 2D geometry. Let's take a look at some other modifications. The bottom left-hand area of the profile. I'm going to select this geometry. I'm also going to select the bottom circle and notice how it's automatically found any co-aligned geometry. And as I move the profile around, again, all of those relations are being honored. What you may notice, however, is that one of the curves didn't have a relation and has actually become detached. It was not a problem. We can just extend it to the profile. And now when we make another modification to the same geometry, you'll notice the relation has been maintained. The final modification in this area is to add another circle, and it's very easy to do. With the control key pressed on the keyboard, I select an existing circle and drag the new copy into position. So let's move up to the top of the profile again and take a look at these ribs. Selecting the rib and then dragging it, again you see the relations have been found and maintained. Now there is an angle on those two lines, but I want to make them parallel. So again, I'm going to make a parallel relation. And this time, I'm going to rotate that rib around the center of this circle. Again, when I select the rib profile, notice now as I drag it, it's been rotated around the arc center. And continue to make some changes. Again, these two pockets here, I'm just going to drag one. Again, notice how the other one is related to it. So that updates two. We're going to make a change to the diameter in this area here. Create a dimension this time. Again, dragging, notice there's an offset relation found. I can relax that if I didn't want it again. So you notice it's only updating the one circle now. And finally, we're going to take a look at the area between the two main diameters in the top portion of the profile. You'll notice that we have two ribs that are connecting the two diameters. Now I'm going to make a change to these, but I'm going to have to use some construction geometry to achieve what I need to. So I'm just going to create a line between the two arc centers, and then I'm going to make these ribs parallel to that line. I'm then going to make them symmetric, and with that relation set, you'll now notice that when I drag one of the curves, because of the symmetric relation and there's a found offset relation, that all the geometry updates as you'd expect. Finally, I'm going to add a dimension for the wall thickness of the rib. I drag it to the approximate position, then specify a dimension. And now, when I drag the ribs themselves, the wall thickness is maintained. Now I could obviously add another dimension to control the space between the two ribs, but for now I'm going to leave it at that. So let's just recap what you've seen. We started off with the DXF file that we imported into NX. We then used the 2D optimize curve command to clean up the geometry and remove any anomalies, and at the same time add it to a sketch. You then saw how the new sketch with inside of NX and its powerful solver automatically recognized relations between various curves within the profile. When I made modifications, those relations were automatically honored and maintained. I think you'll agree that for working effectively with imported 2D geometry, then NX is the tool of choice. So that's the end of the presentation. But if you'd like to find out more about how NX can help transform your design processes, then visit the NX blog. And if you'd like to try NX for free, then visit the trials at the URL you can see on the screen or by using the QR code. So that's all from me. I just want to thank you for your time and attention.